Hello, YouTubers. Welcome back to the channel where Christianity, community, and conversation collide. Today's topic discussion will be love. Now, there are seven different words for love in Greek that we'll be discussing. Forgive me if I mispronounce them as I'm not a Greek scholar. The first one is Eros, Philia, Erotoropia, or ludus, storge, philautia, and pragma. Now, stick around as we come to a better understanding of God's love. So I'm sure you're all wondering what love is the bus really means. Well, one day a friend of mine and I were chatting about people getting saved. And he says, I hope that there's going to be a vehicle, a huge vehicle, big enough to carry all our friends to heaven. So I looked at him and said, love is the bus. Well, at the time, I didn't really understand what I said, but at a later date, it hit me like a brick. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. This is the true love of God that for us human beings is so hard to understand. One of the questions I always struggle with is how can God love a sinner like me so much that he would sacrifice himself so that I may be cleansed of my sins and enter his kingdom? Well, our human minds could never fully comprehend the one who has always been and created all things. Our level of comprehension is finite, and he is an infinite being. This is the type of love we as Christians must strive for. The Greek word to best describe this is agape. It is an unconditional type of love, a universal love, the highest form of love in existence. In fact, without the Holy Spirit, it is impossible for us to love someone in this manner. There are six more Greek words that describe a love that is subpar to the agape love that God gives. Eros is the first one, a romantic, passionate love. Philia is an intimate, authentic friendship. Erotoropia, or ludus, a playful, flirtatious love. Storge, an unconditional love towards family. Philautia, a compassionate self-love. Pragma, a commitment love built on understanding and long-term interests. Now, let's take a look at how Jesus tried to explain agape love during his ministry. John 13:34, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Also are you to love one another. Jesus is trying to tell us to love one another as he loved us. He went a step further here in Matthew 5:43-44. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. These verses paint a picture of what agape love may look like here on earth. And it is certainly attainable through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. The best way for us to get a better understanding of agape love is to continue to look at what Jesus says. John 15:9-10. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So what I gather from these verses is one way to abide in Jesus' love is to follow his commandments. Jesus reflects God's love, and we in turn should reflect Jesus' love to others by keeping his commandments and being selfless. Let's see what Paul says to the Romans through the revelation from Jesus. Romans 8:35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? If none of these things can separate us from the love of God, then we shouldn't allow any of these things to cause us not to have agape love towards other people, whether they are friend or foe. Let's see what Paul writes to the Church of Corinth, 2 Corinthians 14 through 15. For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who, for their sake, died and was raised. I believe this verse means that since Jesus loved us so much that he would die for us, therefore we should also die to ourselves and give the rest of our lives to the will of God. In closing, let's take a look at what Paul says to the church of Ephesus. Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. We as believers should love our significant others, as our marriage actually represents how God looks at his church. During the rapture, he will be looking for his bride, which is the church. For example, right now in the United States, people who are not Christians have a significantly lower divorce rate than those who consider themselves Christian. This is a huge misrepresentation of what God wants. I mean, would you want God to divorce you? Let's all keep this in mind as we interact with our husbands and wives. Let our relationships reflect the manner in which Jesus will treat his church. Otherwise, how will the world ever see a difference between their moral stance compared to the Word of God? At this point, I'd like to thank you all very much for watching. Please drop a comment. Let us know your thoughts on how we can apply an agape type of love to everyday life. Now, our next topic of discussion will be wrath. The title of that video will be "The Wrath of God, Not the Wrath of Blank." You could fill your name in there. So that will be a really awesome discussion. And if you don't want to miss the bus, pun intended, hit that subscribe button, hit that like button, hit that notification bell, so that you can be part of the discussion and you won't miss any of the awesome content. God bless each and every one of you, and I will see you on the next video.